Good evening. It's a beautiful moment for me to come back to this IMA Corporate meeting after many, many years. I must thank Professor Chandrasekharan, senior physician whom I know almost last two decades, whom I admire for his beautiful clinical skills always, who has got a score of students, and senior faculty like Dr. Pandey, Dr. Jayarajan, and many other senior members, madam. Hernia, such a common thing. We wonder what is that new, extra. But in the last, I must say 10 years, all over the last 3-4 years, it has become a specialty of its own. And we started calling it even herniologist. That some general surgeons practicing exclusive hernia surgery. Hernia surgery is becoming more and more complicated cases. From the days of simple groin hernia to ventral hernias, what we see recurrent hernias, loss of domain, people coming with a big hanging apron abdomen. It is not only simply a cosmetic deformity and suffering, it affects a lot of physiology. What we don't realize is, if a person has got a big hole in the abdomen, it affects. And when he or she strains, for example, a simple Wilson was maneuver to pass motion or urine, they can't generate the pressure. It gets deflated here. To be frank with you, even as a practicing surgeon, I didn't realize that for many years. This physiological part. So they suffer. They need a belt or something to compress like this. Then they've got a huge hernia. Then only they can pass motion or urine. Now when they try to strain, the pressure is not generated. So it's not very simple. Similarly, when you've got a ventral hernia, the person's certainty will not be quenched, I mean, filled immediately. Because we feel, when you write, you can understand, when you wear a tight pant, you can't eat more. When the stomach wall gets in compressed against the wall, you feel like stopping eating. These people, because the abdomen is bulging, it becomes a vicious cycle. They keep on eating, not feeling full, the abdomen keeps bulging. So they become more and more difficult candidate for correction even. So with this introduction in mind, what is there to worry about actually? So what was something which is introduced as a very youngster becomes a giant? That's what has become. Sachin was a kid at 16 years when he entered the Team India. Now he has become a legend and retired too. Of course, hernia will never retire. It has become really a giant at the moment. Hernia has been documented from BC days. And original treatment for hernia was cauterization of the skin there, so the skin shrivels, gets adherent, goes in. From those days it is there, from the papers, from the size of Celsus and Galen, it's a well-known. It is there in the Egyptian mummies, some of them also. And of course, the old timers know about the truss which they used to use. When they can't repair, put a compression and leave it. Even I have seen truss belts in my childhood, people wearing it. I remember my village station master used to have a special belt, do it with a jerk like this and put it in. So it's all fun, you know. Now it's condemned rather. What is happening? We all need a tissue repair. In fact, when I learned surgery, not very long ago, I must say early 90s, that I have seen hernia repair being done with a number 2 silk bassinis repair. They put a used to a 3 strong number 2 silk, put it together and that's all. Not that all the patients had recurrence. Not that all had recurrence. It also worked. Vaseline repair also worked. But then we realized there are better methods of doing it. That is not correct. And tissue repair had a big recurrence rate, sometimes even up to 40%, 10 to 40%. In fact, the tissue repairs which I have done 25 years ago, some of the patients whom I am following, I used to do shoulders with the number 1 proline before the Mashira came. Became a norm. Some of them are doing very well. No recurrence. Some of them are in the 70s, in the 8th decade. So most defects could be closed. And some of them cannot be closed. You can't put them in tension. The two principles in surgery is there should be no ischemia, no tension. In anything you put together, it may be bone, it may be nerve, it may be vessel, tendon, tissues, the general principle is no tension. So the tension-free repair came. That's when the meshplasty came into prominence. In fact, even when I did my MS, I hardly saw a meshplasty. I don't remember seeing it even that. Tissue repair was the norm. Then we all have to change. So with a lot of experiments came how to. Where do you place the mesh? I used to give the patient a simple example. One old cloth is there, 25-year-old shirt, torn or styling. If you stitch them together, the surrounding tissues of the same old cloth, it will tear away the edges. The same thing happens to tissues. So when you put a very pure tissue repair, especially in a ventral hernia, some people have got tendency for hernia. All the collagens are not seen. Some people have got recurrent shoulder dislocation, even as a young person. So your collagens are basically different. They are prone for it. So we need something like a patchwork. It gives the extra support. So we give them the example of RC concrete roofing. You put a metal grid over which the cement sticks together. Similarly, when you put a mesh, when the collagen grows over the mesh, it remains stronger. It is supposed to give you strength for your whole life, for all normal strains and the pressures you generate inside the abdomen. Unless you generate supranormal overstrain. For example, I used to tell them that craning is meant by God or nature to protect normal injuries, but not for 60 km speed in a 2-wheeler without helmet. It will definitely break. So every tissue has got a tensile strength which we should respect. Where do you put the mesh? It can be on the tissue. Take my pointer. So the only, you do the opposition of the tissues together, put a mesh on it. But nowadays we realize that position is not recommended routinely because it is not physiologically correct position. Only is the one which I have done hundreds of surgeries, only. Very comfortable, easy to do, technically very simple. You don't need to do anything because most of the abdominal labs, you put the tissues together, put a nice overlapping mesh and come out. And they are doing very well. But the problem is the mesh is exposed to the subcutaneous space. More prone for infection. Always more seroma. We raise a big flag. And many patients come with hanging abdomen. So we do abdominoplasty together. And apron abdomen is a pathology by itself. They develop intertrigo. They have problem in walking and balancing, such a weight pulling them down. Sometimes they have removed even as big as 5 kilos of the panniculus when you do abdominoplasty. Inlay is the one we put it underneath. That means the defect cannot be closed. You use the mesh to cover the defect. When you cannot close, the mesh is used as a supplement. That is inlay. Sublay is the most optimal position which we try to attain. That is behind the muscle, behind the rectus. The principle is, now we have understood, repairing hernia is not only simply restoring the anatomy but finding a midline closure properly. It is physiological too. It's the anchorage point. Suppose you analyze the human body from cranium to foot, you have got some bony component supporting from top. Anteriorly you have got the cranium, here you have got the neck, here you have got some of the cartilages and bones. Once you come to back, you have got sternum and spine, but abdomen, you lack that bony component. Here, the linea alba is a very important equivalent for the bony support, for the balancing. We have to put money in the brain and side, but not the front. So linea alba is not simply a structure, but that's where the lateral muscles come and get anchored. All of the rotation, movement, stability, posture, everything depends on integrity of linea alba. That's why we refer sometimes divarication of rectus, though it is not big symptomatic, which very commonly we see in people with multiparous movement, very common. IPOM, we know, intraperitoneal culture, misnomer calling it only, we put it from inside laparoscopically. So that is not a very ideal position, but very comfortable, simple surgery. You put it from inside, but immediate post-op pain is very high in IPOM, though it's a laparoscopic surgery, because the fixation is transfacial. It creates a lot of pain in the first few days. IPOM plus, we close the defect along with IPOM. Now this is describing the same thing. Only the mesh comes on the top, inlay is bridging it, sublay is behind the muscle, and IPOM is in the peritoneum. Of course, these two people play a very important role in the component separation technique. What we call is mean by component separation is when the edges are not coming together in the middle, we have to give a lateral relief and bring the midline together by some means. The midline has to be closed. Now what do you do if you have got a big defect like 10-15 centimeter defect, which is very rare? Most defects are 4 centimeters, 3 centimeters, 5 centimeters. We can do in a simple manner. When you have got a big defect, Dr. Oscar Ramirez, one of the very prominent figures, developed this anterior component separation. What he did was, beyond the linea semilunaris, the lateral border of the rectus abdominis, he made a cut laterally and brought the, mobilized the external oblique aponeurosis further forward. You can mobilize up to 6 to 8 centimeters and form a closure. Now you can ask what will happen to this lateral part where you have made a cut. That's a weak spot. You can have a lateral bulge. But at the cost of lateral bulge, you try to bring the midline up position. But again the same thing, when you have to go up to lateral part, you have to raise a big flap. So large seroma, the fluid draining for many days, and infection chance, and on labesh if you use, again the problems of that. And this gentleman, Yuri Novitsky, in his mid-40s, in 2006, came up with a very beautiful observation. I want you to pay attention now, what I am going to tell you. If you remember your classical anatomy textbooks, when we see the cut section of the anterior abdominal wall, you know all the three lateral muscles come. External oblique, internal oblique, transversus. The aponeurosis of the external oblique contribute to anterior tissue. The internal oblique comes, splits into two. One part goes to anterior rectus, one part goes to posterior rectus. And transversus contributes to posterior tissue. We are all familiar with this anatomy. But we all thought all the muscle components stop lateral to semilunaris. Linear semilunaris, medial to that, there is no lateral flank muscle, we thought. And in a cataract dissection about 13-14 years ago, this gentleman, Dr. Yuri Novitsky from USA, found out some muscular component is there in the PRS, posterior cushion. This is a very, in fact, if you see anatomy textbook even today, what I told you initially only is described. Except hernia textbooks, none of the textbooks describe the modern change now. He did a cadaver section, only three cadavers, not even very big numbers. He found out that posterior, the transversus abdominis extends beyond the linear semilunaris and owns almost one-third or two-thirds of the posterior tertiary behind, especially the upper part. Upper part. At the umbilical level and below it may not be any. So it's not straight line. It becomes like this. Now, what he realized, once you make a cut in the posterior rectus sheath, medial to the point where the neurocutaneous, the component enters and supplies the muscles, you don't damage the nerves. Before him, some doctors tried going between transverse abdominis and internal oblique, and they damage the nerves and permanently paralyze the rectus abdominis, creating a big bulge which can never be repaired, can never be innervated. It's a permanent damage. People have paid prices for this experimentation. And when this gentleman found out this, what we call is transverse abdominal release. Now we famous known as TAR, T-A-R. The TAR has taken the world by storm. And that makes and helps all of us to bridge large defects, even 15 centimeters can be brought. Once you open the, now you see this component. See, anterior component separation, you cut the external oblique and you bridge it together. Posterior component separation, you cut here between internal oblique and transversus. But here is where all the neurocutaneous, the plane that comes. But here, you cut here, this muscle part of the muscle and posterior tertiary, and you go between peritoneum and transversus fascia here and the muscle. Here you can go up to completely the flank. You can go to the anterior axillary sheath, this line, anterior axillary line. So from flank to flank, you put a 30 by 30 mesh, two meshes you put. So this is what we call the GPRDS, the great peritoneal repair, the visceral sac, large visceral sac. You cover the whole thing, all the existing hernial defects as well as potential future. You put a large mesh from one anterior axillary line to other anterior axillary line, you cover all the defects. No defect can escape now. This is actually on table, posterior and anterior component separations, a comparative analysis. This is the rectus muscle, this is the tar incision line, these are all the neurocutaneous fibers entering, just medial to that. The moment you open, you have a big space. You go by a blunt dissection, you go behind. Now you can reach anywhere, parastomal hernia, lateral hernia, median midline hernia, everything you can repair with that. One single problem. I mean, one single technique. The newest kit is the heat tip. The same, see, tip, you know, we talk about the tap and tip in laparoscopic groin hernia repair. The transabdominal pre-peritoneal and totally extra-peritoneal. So, I personally feel going into the peritoneal cavity to repair something on the wall, we are violating the principles. We say three things should not be violated. Generally, one is trachea, urethra, and peritoneum. Of course, when Dr. Padani is there, I can say even probably CSF, the subarachnoid space. Don't violate them unnecessarily. Unless there's an indication strongly for it. Don't catheterize patient left and right. If you have got the patients, wait and watch. Many of my patients, above 80, I've got a big list of people above 80 whom I've operated. I use a hernia surgery and local anesthesia. Only groin block. I tell them, like a dentist pulling out your tooth, we do the hernia repair. We use ropey ventane now for more safety, because even if it gets intravascular, it doesn't produce depression, cardiac toxicity. Otherwise, I come in ropey ventane with normal xylocaine. And dilute them and use it for groin repair. I've got a big number of people above 75, 80, 85. And nobody has been catheterized so far. Even the prostatic age group, when you do surgery under local, at the end of surgery, the patient walks to the bathroom, has his lunch or dinner, whatever it is. Very comfortable, very safe. Finally, we want a safe outcome. That is what is very, very important. The solution should not be more serious and complicated than the problem itself. We should be very clear. Just because I got a spoon and fork, I don't try to eat chapati with spoon and fork. Rice is beautiful. So I tell them with every armamentarium that is coming in our way, we should know how to use. Now this heat tip. The tip is there for quite some time, almost 20 years now. We do the hernia repair of the groin by doing totally extra peritoneal. You make a small nick in the pararectal tissue, I mean paramedian, go behind the rectus. The moment you go below the linea semicircularis, where posterior fascia gets over, you are in the preperitoneal plane. Then you go up to the pelvis, you see the pubic symphysis and the tibia, you push down the hernial sac, put a large mesh and come out. No fixation, no drain, for your, because the plane is already covered. That's in the beautiful place. See the Pascal's principles, if you understand, when the pressure is generated within the abdomen, if you give a support behind the muscle, the mesh will go and hit the muscle only. Suppose you put the mesh on the muscle, if the defect is blown out, the mesh also will get blown out, hernia will occur. You understand the point? Suppose there is a door, there is a stampede in this room. We have put a big plank of board from inside. You can't break that, you go. Whereas if the wooden board is kept outside the door, we can go through the door, push the plank, it will fall away there. If I try to push the plank here, it will go and hit the wall only. That will fall away. That is what the difference between on-lay and under-lay, the sub-lay. Sub-lay is the best position, the retrorectus, below the muscle. So when the pressure comes, that mesh beautifully gets sandwiched between the muscle and the intra-abdominal pressure organs. So when that pressure is there, even collagen laying is very uniform. You know, collagen laying is subjected to pressure. That's what we use in treating the scar. No? When you use a contractive or some scar solution, we try to apply the apparent solution and try to massage. So the scar gets even. It does not get heaped up like a hypertrophic scar or a keloid. The same thing can occur. You can develop a scar plate as hard. That will not develop. So the heat cap now we use, we go laparoscopically and open any repair. Of course, it's more difficult as you go up. Infra-umbilical relatively easy. So this is called an extended tip. Totally extra-peritoneal repair. You go behind, see the defect under mission. Of course, the recovery is definitely faster. whenever you do something with minimally invasive procedure.
SCOLA,
subcutaneous only laparoscopic approach. So what we do typically in open surgery, the patient doesn't have a big apron abdomen, you don't need to do paniculectomy. You go underneath the skin, see under vision, you see the hernia, repair it and pull it back. You have only two cuts and put one small ring and come out. So SCOLA is another armamentarium, very simple, least invasive, and we achieve the purpose. What I do for complex hernias? Simple hernias, leave it. Anybody can do, we think, but it is not so. Hernia, we think a postgraduate student first year can do at the end of 1 year. No. It needs a lot of supervision. We never understand the nerve anatomy. Every problem comes with the misunderstanding the nerves. And chronic pain in the groin, which is developing as a big specialty by itself. Just because you have a successful hernia repair, it doesn't mean everything is over. I always tell them, a surgeon, if he touches a patient, he's for life, you are answerable to him. Just because the skin wound has healed and he has gone back home, it doesn't mean the relationship is over. He can come 6 months later with a sinus. He has some discharge, some infection, some recurrence. He'll blame it on that too. So it's very, very important when you do. Defect closure is very, very important with component separation as per the need. Sometimes only. Sometimes the components are very thin. Literally papery thin. You can't split them out. Then you do a safe only and come. Albeit, we carry an extra risk of little more seroma, infection prevention protocol. I had so many of them before we took up the subline in a serious manner. Of course, heat up and combine up. Abdominoplasty, tummy tuck. This lady, wife of a senior police officer, which I did about 1.5 years ago, you can see the way, even when she is lying down, how it is hanging down. And when we removed this much fat, we removed paniculectomy. So this is a big 2.5 to 3 feet cut. But they are very happy at the end. For many years later, they are seeing their own feet when they look down. It is blocking. They are very happy. This is a large umbilical hernia. We make a large incision like this. You see the way, the neck is very narrow. And so much momentum is coming out and not going back. We do the omentectomy. This is a ventral X mesh. This either goes into the prepatorial or intrapatorial as per the separation we make. I try to put it in the prepatorial space. Very simple method, little costly mesh, around 25,000. And we fix it and come out. This is abdominoplasty after clearance. This is a bilateral direct hernia. This gentleman from Assam. I have done so many of the ultra pro hernia system. It is not a simple mesh, but a double legged mesh. So one component lies in the preparatorial plane, one is in the on plane. So this is considered to be the best repair for the groin, which gives the best support. Combining the best of the minimally invasive as well as the open procedure. We call it the anterior approach to the preparatorial plane, which is my favorite. You see the big bulge, you can see the way, how big is the sac. And this gentleman is doing well, still in conversation with the over phone as how he is doing. This is a classical group of patients whom I see, young ladies who have got one child. Child is 2 to 3 years old, who want to become pregnant again. But there is an umbilical hernia, there is an apron abdomen. What do you do first? We can't put a mesh. The abdomen has to expand. So you do simply a tissue repair with a PDS, polydirectional suture, which is a delayed absorbent suture. No foreign body. So you do abdominoplasty, you correct the defect, and you can even create a new umbilicus. What it looks like. And I got about half a dozen patients who have got second child after this, and they did not require second surgery. But we always want them, because I am not doing a mesh plasty, you stand a higher chance of hernia. They accept it. So once you explain to the patient the risks involved and the chances, one thing what you should remember before any surgery, all the more hernia, is to quit smoking 1 month in advance, not a few days, minimum 1 month. Smoking increases, delayed healing creates infection chance and recurrence. If you explain this to patient, no patient will take a chance. I remember one CEO of a company who came, very busy man, His company, doctor accompanied everything. Yes, doctor, I want surgery tomorrow. I have planned everything. 2 weeks later, I got a meeting in Europe. And he was smelling of cigarette. I said, very nice, Mr. George, I don't mind operating on you. But you stand a chance of higher infection rate and recurrence. Then he was taken aback. What about my meeting in Europe? I said, I don't care. I am concerned about your healing. Your meeting is your day. You can schedule a little later. Then he came 1 month later. The best problem, the worst problem that comes in a surgeon's career is getting carried away by the VIP patients. I have operated on ministers, MPs, MLAs, and in army or general mixtures, the problems come usually for them, not for the normal people. Because we tend to cut corners and not tell them all the risks involved while operating. If you treat them like normal individual, like any other patient, they go smooth. Inside the room, you are the consultant, he is the patient, it may be Prime Minister, Chief Minister, in your chamber. If you treat them like normal, okay, you can call them, sir, get up and receive. That's all. Beyond that, the equation is very clear in your chamber. You are consulting his patient. If you put it that way, they also respect you more, you do a better job. This is another lady. Hostile abdomen. I cannot find a better word. This lady, I tried my level best to avoid a surgery. She has undergone 6 times, we can make out the scar, one vertical, one transverse, one here. She underwent a simple appendicectomy, went into complication, had ileostomy, then closure, she is shattered. She was a bit about 5 kilos overweight, which most of our ladies are. And I was giving that as a reason not to operate on her. You try to lose that weight. I was really keen not to operate. It's a bug back to enter an abdomen like this. And over and above, she has got a ovarian cyst and a uterine polyp, cervical polyp. So the gynecologist said, you have to do total abdominal hysterectomy with the salping oophorectomy. 46 years she was old when I operated. To enter the abdomen, it took 2 hours for me. And to go to the uterus took that much time. Hysterectomy took another 1 hour. Then, 4.5 hours, I have not started the hernia surgery at all. Totally plastered abdomen. We successfully finished the surgery of hysterectomy in 4.5 hours. I came back and told the attenders, it is only halfway through. We did the surgery. You can see the way abdomen looks with adherent internal perforations and abdomen. Look at the peritoneum momentum. This is the way it looked. I did the only ultra-pro hernia mesh. Still there was a defect. Under me, I used a fascia later, which I kept it as inlay. Because nothing could be finished. It's all thick plates. And finally, this was the thing. She developed a small flap necrosis here, which we covered 7 days after surgery. Little advancement flap from below and covered it. Now almost going to be 2 years now, she is doing well. She came for review 2 weeks ago. This lady can never forget. We spent about 7.5 hours in surgery in doing this complex hernia. So complex hernias are not simple surgery, but in the eyes of common man, and probably even high court judge, they say, after all hernia, you can't afford a death. Complications are much more than many so-called malignant conditions. When you say malignancy, people accept all complications. It can be a simple mastectomy, it can be oophorectomy, whatever it is you do, colectomy. That goes very smooth. Compared to this hernia, most of the abdominal surgeries are very simple. But people won't realize, public won't realize. So you have to spend time talking to your patients and attenders, not undermine the complication rates. Explain to them what you are going to do, what you are trying to achieve. So they have realistic expectations. And they say, what is the recurrence rate of hernia? You reach for enough time, every hernia will recur. If you live long enough, your collagen will become weak. Like your skin sagging. At 70 years, your skin is not as good as your 25-year-old. It has to stand. So you explain to patients, like every cloth will tear and grow old if you keep it for 50 years. So exactly, if you explain to patients, they do understand and accept. And for all practical purpose, the hernia repairs we do serve the patients lifelong. With the normal, their wear and tear and the straining. So don't give them a threatening picture. All hernia is going to recur. We have got hundreds of patients who are doing very well and still on follow-up. And we used to tell them the regular follow-up protocol. First 1 month, every up to 3 months, then at 6 months, then 1 year, then annual lifelong.
Failure can come after 20 years.
Recurrence.
It is not your failure.
We call it a metabolic failure. Because paralysis become weak on their own. See, by your silk saree today, in 1 month if it tears, it's a manufacturing defect, old saree. But if it tears after 10 years, you can't blame the manufacturer. It's a wear and tear. The same thing can occur with any tissue. If you make these principles clear, and another most important thing what every surgeon, but most of us don't practice is surgical nutrition, which is very clear to my, and closer to my heart. I correct the albuminin part, anemia, all the things. I tell them, they take eggs, I tell them 3-4 egg whites every day. The albumin is given. Vitamin C correction, high protein diet, not straining. Abdomen bent support for 3 months. We tell them to avoid contact with public and cough and all strain manner. Avoiding constipation. If a patient has got BPH, correct that first. If we do all this, we are going to have a successful outcome and happy clients. This is Chennai Hernia Center, created specifically for hernia surgery. And we have the patients with real complicated problems who can be addressed and treated properly. Thank you, gentlemen. Hernia is a specialty by itself within general surgery, has gone a big way. In fact, coming May 2020, we have got an international Olympiad on hernia. We have got an international conference in Mumbai, where we have the, all these giants whom you saw, Dr. Novitsky, everybody is coming. We have a big meeting for 3 days in Mumbai in May. Thank you. Thank you. Any questions, please? Yeah, it depends on the size and the complaints, madam. At the end of the day, if the patient sees, he's happy, don't touch it. Very simple. Absolutely. But one thing what happens is, I have got a big list of people above 80 coming with obstruction and incarceration also. So if it is an acceptable risk, you tell them. You tell them. That's why I said if it is a growing hernia, I do it under local anesthesia with the least surgical and anesthesia risk problem. Without any risk of retraction of urine. Some of them do it done as even daycare. They come in the morning, go back in the evening. Even at 18 plus, we don't even admit them for a full one-day admission. So it can be done safely with the people. Anesthetics are excellent. We give them tap block. So they are pain-free and comfortable. They do very well now.
What are the transfer
What is that? Depends on the size of the defect, man. Depends on the size of the defect. Larger the size, they rarely go for obstruction, but it keeps fully expanding. So if you delay, your treatment is going to be more difficult. So when the defect is small, better to repair. Everything carries a risk. Nothing is zero risk. Nothing is zero risk. But if you understand, it's acceptable and we are doing very well. So age alone is not a criteria to deny anybody a surgery in the modern era. I think so.
Is there a lifespan for a mesh like other for valves and pacemaker, there's a lifespan, any replacement? Is there any lifespan for a mesh?
That's a beautiful question, Dr. Primary. there's no lifespan for it. You can get integrated with your own tissues. Unlike an orthopedic implant, which is kept outside, if it gets worn out, you remove and put another one. Mesh you cannot do. Mesh we remove if it is infected. It has to be come out. Of course, I have done quite a good number of mesh infection of other doctors. Nobody can say it will not happen in my hands. I only pray it doesn't happen in my hands. It can occur with anybody. If one of the UHS patients had a superficial infection, I remove the only online component. He's still coming doing well. If the mesh is infected, nothing short of removal of implant will solve the problem. Of course, one word you all must be aware, the non-tuberculous mycobacterial infection, NTM, atypical mycobacteria. That's a big menace if you don't have sterile instruments and take care. Still, the things have come down incidence with awareness, but definitely, hernia surgery is not for wandering laparoscopic surgeons, carrying the lab equipment in formalin chambers. The equipment has to be sterilized properly and no chance taken. You should leave no stone unturned in sterilization process. That's very important.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
sir. Thank you for inviting us in the heaven. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Now I invite Dr. Chaudappa to hand over the ceremony.
Mr. Podium,
thank you, sir. Thank you.
Regarding Ernia, one point I want to say.
Regarding Ernia, if you go to the 18th edition paper, the danger is not due to hernia, it's due to delay. This is the aphorism is given in the beginning.
Absolutely. Thank you, sir. See, the point, that's what we tell. When patient asks about the risk of life, death, everything, never underplay it. Please say, never try to catch a patient outright. I remember one of my senior faculty, Professor Devarajan in Apollo Hospital Hospitals, Kenji Vaidyan Bhakada, don't beckon outright. And never do a substandard, cost-effective surgery. If it is this much cost, with all equipments monitoring, you need them. There is no shortcut. He says you are only a doctor to the patient, not auditor to the patient. Every poor patient will come and say, sir, I would not have bargained with you. It's a very common thing we come across. They will bargain with you. நம்ம எப்ப கெஞ்சி வைத்தியம் பண்ண பார்க்குறோமோ அப்போதான் எல்லா பிரச்சனையும் வரும். வாட் எவர் ஹஸ் டு கம் டு யூ இட் வில் கம். இந்தியா இஸ் அ பிக் கண்ட்ரி வித் எனஃப் பாப்புலேஷன். நோ டாக்டர் இஸ் அ காம்படிட்டர் டு எனிபடி. எவ்ரி ஒன் ஹஸ் காட் தேர் ஓன் கிளைண்ட் திங். அஸ் லாங் அஸ் தி சர்வ் வெல், வி வில் ஹேவ் அ பிரெட் அண்ட் பட்டர் வித்வுட் வரி. தட் ஐ கேன் அஷூர் யூ வித் ஆஸ் அ டாக்டர் ஃபார் 35 இயர்ஸ் நவ் அண்ட் சர்ஜன் ஃபார் 5 இயர்ஸ். லெட் அஸ் பீ அண்ட் நெவர் கெட் ஹாப்பினஸ் இன் சம்படிஸ் ப்ராப்ளம். Never, if somebody's case dies, complication, never feel happy. Tomorrow morning it will come to you. It is waiting to come, especially for the surgeon.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for you.
That's very, very important. Let us all live like beautiful brothers and sisters and privileged. The day I operate, I feel first privilege has come. I am not a patient on the table. I am a surgeon operating. Second privilege, economic reward. If you feel that way, it's the most beautiful profession ever you can have, being a doctor. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I will move on to the next doctor. Next, following our own senior members, I now invite our past president, Dr. Yuvraj Singh, to take over the floor.